declaring the end from the beginning. To him who overcomes, I will give to eat from the tree of life, which is in the midst of the paradise of God. And the Lord God formed man of the dust of the ground, and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living being. May the God of peace himself sanctify you completely, and your whole spirit, soul, and body be preserved blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. A threefold cord is not quickly broken. Bear fruit to God, that your fruit should remain.
Hello, Harmony friends. May your tuning in bring about favor to you and shalom from the Most High God, Yahuwah, our Father, and from our Master, Jesus the Messiah, Yahushua HaMashiach. In this presentation, we will further our understanding of the physical implications and spiritual downgrade that has resulted from Eve's disobedience. Now, to gain spiritual insight, one must start with the natural. Meet the Roy G. Biv family. They are a family ambassador of the visible light that makes up less than 1% of the total electromagnetic spectrum. Visible light is what represents the natural, and the rest we are unable to comprehend, so it represents the spiritual realm. So the light family's perception and ability to express themselves is limited by the 7 colors of the spectrum, which is only about 1% of the total bigness of the universal spectrum. The Roy G. Biv family as a whole makes up white light, but is expressed into 7 individual wavelengths and frequencies that we can perceive as colors. That's red, orange, yellow, green, blue, indigo, and violet. Hence the abbreviation Roy G. Biv. These range in frequencies from 400 to 700 nanometers. Everything visible and comprehensible for humans on this earth is found in these frequency of colors. Now, 3 out of these 7 colors are set apart, as we can parallel these extra special colors to the peculiarity of the Melchizedek priesthood. The first special color is the longest wavelength of them all, and that is red. In the Bible, this is code for the first man, Adam, which in Hebrew also means to be red. Our second set-apart color is blue. And since the sky reflects blue light off of the waters in the earth and in the heavens, we can parallel blue to represent the heavens or divinity. So when the breath of the Creator blew his neshama, which is something of the heavens, into Adam's face, which we know as the red man, the person of Adam filled with the neshama, or the breath of the Creator, is really exhibiting for us the colors red and blue. What comes out when combining both of these colors is purple. Purple represents royalty or rulership. Note that all 3 set-apart colors are a part of the visible white or light spectrum. White signifying purity and righteousness. Both red and blue, combined as purple, exemplifies for us the first Adam, the first Melchizedek. This Hebrew title is broken down as follows. Melchi, meaning my king, my counsel, and Zadik, meaning righteousness or righteous. Adam was the first king and counselor of righteousness over all of what encompasses the visible light spectrum, and that is the rest of the colors of the spectrum, and that's orange, yellow, green, indigo. These colors make up what we know of today as earth. Remember the high priest's garments from the last presentation? Note that the garment itself is featured in 4 colors: sky blue, royal purple, blood crimson, woven onto a background of pure snow white linen. Adam, who knew no sin, became sin by giving up his neshama for his bride Eve. Just like in Adam's name, you see the word dam, which means blood in Hebrew. We see why Paul calls him as a type of Messiah who was to come. Messiah's blood shed to atone for our souls. Interesting to note that this visible light spectrum, the colors in which we are limited to comprehend in this life, is walled in by ultraviolet and infrared invisible light frequencies that are both considered to be of health and healing frequencies, specifically the ultraviolet B or UVB and the ultraviolet A or UVA light and infrared A or IRA. These light frequencies help our body to produce the hormone vitamin D sulfate on the skin, producing melatonin and dopamine. Think of the invisible or the spiritual covering or hovering over the visible light or natural. Both infrared and ultraviolet are invisible forces or light spectrum that act as our shield and buckler in the natural. Psalms 91:4. He shall cover you with his feathers, and under his wings you shall take refuge. His truth shall be your shield and buckler. Psalm 91:11-12. For he shall give his angels charge over you to keep you in all your ways. In their hands they shall bear you up, lest you dash your foot against a stone. Envision Psalm 91 in these invisible light spectrum, painting a picture of divine protection in the middle of the visible storms of life in the natural realm. His wings and feathers cover and deflect, and his angels guard and protect us. According to Malachi 4:2, there is healing in the wings of the sun. It says, "But to you who fear my name," or revere my name, "the Son of Righteousness shall arise with healing in his wings." Doesn't that sound like a sun nutrient that we can intake that will bring about healing? The perfect dose of sunrise light frequency helps set the body up to better absorb sunlight later in the day, that's around solar noon, to make vitamin D, as well as to protect us against excessive sun exposure. Did you catch that? By setting our eyes and exposing your skin to the light frequencies available in the sunrise and in the sunset, you are not only getting natural sunscreen, you're also getting primed to receive the healing benefits of the natural light frequencies. Psalms 121:1, "I will lift up my eyes to the hills. From where does my help come?" And then verse 6 says, "The sun shall not strike you by day, nor the moon by night." So when I think of infrared and ultraviolet, or the red or the purple frequencies of color the light gives off, I think of Yahushua, Jesus the Messiah, the last Adam, who was crowned with glory and honor. Hebrews 2:9 says, "But we see Jesus, Yahushua, who was made a little lower than the angels for the suffering of death, crowned with glory and honor, that he, by the grace of Elohim, might taste death for everyone." Isaiah 53:5 also says, "By his stripes we are healed." Again, do you see how consistent the physical demonstration of the healing benefits of the sun in relation to both physical and spiritual healing that we get through the Sun of Righteousness? Everything we see in the natural world is to teach us the spiritual. Just as the sun is as necessary for all types of life on earth, without it, life would cease to exist. It is even more essential for us to depend on the Son of the Most High God, the last Adam, who became the life-quickening spirit. Why are we so physically dependent on the Son? So much so that the sun is mistakenly worshipped by mankind all throughout history. Ever thought of that? Plants are drawn towards the sun. Satellites face the sun. This corruptible flesh is enslaved to the sun, it seems. We know in Revelation that there will be no sun in the kingdom. The narrative of the garden story, notice there was no mention of sun. Ever wonder why in Revelation it states that there will be no sun in the kingdom? Revelation 21:23, and the city had no need of the sun, neither of the moon to shine in it. For the glory of Elohim did lighten it, and the lamp is the light thereof. The second mention is in Revelation 22:5, and there shall be no night there, and they need no candle, neither light of the sun, for Yahuwah Elohim giveth them light, and they shall reign forever and ever. Now take note of the garden story narrative. In Genesis 2, notice there was no mention of sun. There's no sea, no mention of any sea creatures. In fact, just before Adam was formed, there was no rain. Only mist that watered the ground, meaning the water cycle hasn't started yet, since the garden, the trees of the garden, did not depend on the sun. In the last presentation, we noted that as a result of the fall, Adam and Eve literally had to be covered by skin to help them survive the outside world. Now, after the fall, just as everything pertaining to life itself that we know of as humans is sun-dependent. Also in the Son of the Most High God, Yahushua, we now also live and move and have our being. We are to depend on Him and Him alone. Until you make the unconscious conscious, the part we don't know will direct our lives. So it is important to increase our understanding as to why we need the covering or atonement of our Messiah. Just as life is dependent completely on the sun, we need to depend on the sun of righteousness. Could our dependency on the physical sun, as well as our dependency on the spiritual sun, have something to do with the Creator's warning in the consequences of eating of the forbidden fruit that Adam and Eve partook from and has caused their eyes to be opened? Or should I say, eyes wide shut? In Genesis 3:5, we see the warning, and it states, "For Elohim knows that in the day you eat of it, your eyes will be opened, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil." Was Adam and Eve's eyes not open prior to the fall? The text seemed to imply that in their pre-fallen state, their eyes seemed to be shut closed, and only after eating from the forbidden tree that their eyes opened. Or could it be that they started to observe what was previously not seen? After the disobedience, they were now exposed. What was exposed to them? Could it be that the fall made them aware of their separation from the Creator's neshama, away from their beings, was now made visible to them? All of a sudden, they were naked of the neshama of life that the Creator breathed into them. Note that Paul refers to two things that makes mankind unique to all of Yahuwah's creation. In 1 Corinthians 15:49, "And as we have born," in Greek, this means to put on, "the image of the man of dust, we shall also bear the image of the heavenly man." First, we put on the image of the man of dust from the soil or ground of the earth. We are earthen vessels made to contain or carry something. Second, we are to bear the image of the heavenly man, Yahushua, the word, the breath of Yahuwah. When Eve disobeyed what was in them, the neshama, the breath, the glory of Yahuwah, left their earthen tabernacle, just like how the glory of Yahuwah left the temple in Ezekiel 10:18. Then the glory of Yahuwah departed from off the threshold of the house and stood over the cherubims. In Ezekiel 11:23, we see the Shekinah glory now moves from the east gate to the Mount of Olives, altogether abandoning the temple. Since the glory of Yahuwah left Adam and Eve, they immediately tried to remedy the problem by their own works, strengths. In Genesis 3:7, then the eyes of both of them were opened and they knew that they were naked, and they sewed fig leaves together and made themselves covering. But clearly it's not enough, since we see the Creator having to cover them with tunics of skin. So it seems that their eyes were split opened and they both realized that they were naked of the glory of Yahuwah. And so would healing of the eyes be a part of the solution? Healing in that there will be a joining or renewing once again of this earthly vessel, renewed into the glory of Yahuwah, having glorified body as a net result. So far, there seems to be a connection with eyes opened and new covering of skin that Adam and Eve obtained. If we take a quick peek at the Hebrew construct of the word skin, you will see the Hebrew letter ayin. In Hebrew, ayin means eyes. The phonetic pronunciation of these two words are identical, yet they mean two very different things. Both words are spelled with a silent first letter aleph for light and ayin for skin, followed by resh. Later on, the silent first letter was assigned the O sound. So now you see the word light in Hebrew, Strong's 216, is or, and the word skin in Hebrew, Strong's 5785, is also or. We also go by the principle of declaring the end from the beginning. So perhaps the connection to what seems to be a nonsensical issue concerning their eyes and skin covering can be seen in Revelation 3:18, where it says, "I counsel you to buy from me gold refined in the fire, that you may be rich, and white garments, that you may be clothed, that the shame of your nakedness may not be revealed, and anoint your eyes with eye salve, that you may see." In the Greek, this word eye salve is defined as a healing cream. Further down the etymology, eye salve is kaleo, to glue together, cement, or fasten together. So the healing eye balm will have something to do with gluing back together over the eyes. Perhaps this healing eye balm will also be the solution to getting our glorified bodies glued back to our earthen vessels. Now Matthew 6:22 and Luke 11:34 may be able to add to the connection we are making with eyes and skin. The lamp of the body is the eye. "If therefore your eye is good, your whole body will be full of light." That's Matthew 6:22. In Luke 11:34, it says, "The lamp of the body is the eye. Therefore, when your eye is good, your whole body also is full of light. But when your eye is bad, your body also is full of darkness." Important note here, Luke was a physician, and so his profession and expertise is in the body. Interesting to point out as well that Luke in Greek is Lucas, which means light giving. I hope you see the connection that the substance of his expertise in our physiological makeup and the essence of his message about the humanity of Yahushua, Jesus the Messiah, highlights the light of the person of Yahusha in us, to bring about the light from within us. Another thing to notice, both Matthew and Luke specifically refers to a single eye, not eyes, not in the plural. Here's an interesting word study. Search out these words in the Bible. Eye without the S at the end and eyes, plural. Eye singular and eyes, plural. And note the difference between the singular eye and the plural? You're probably asking the question, okay, does it matter? Well, perhaps it does. Could it be that prior to the fall, Adam and Eve had a singleness of mind? They had eyes that can see and glorified bodies or light covering for their bodies. After the fall, they were introduced to double-mindedness. They have eyes but cannot see. They now have ears but cannot hear. This is the duality of eyes and ears, and in nature itself, they now have skin to cover their bodies. Their light within them, entrapped, drastically reduced in intensity. They have become earthly tabernacles without the connection to the glory of Yahuwah. They were light covered when they had their spiritual eyes turned on. They were one with the Father in the garden, but when their spiritual eyes became dumbed down, their physical eyes became the dominant player, making them spiritually blinded and skin covered. You will see a connection between blindness and covering in the new covenant in the Greek word poru. That's G4456, transliterated as blinded and hardened. One of the definitions of this Greek word is to cover with a thick skin, to harden by covering with a callus, or make heart dull, or to lose the power of understanding. So when Adam and Eve received eyes that cannot spiritually see, what came along with that is their skin covering, their thickened covering, covering that can be hardened or calloused. Is there a further connection between eyes and skin? Well, yes, there is. Just a bit of research will reveal that modern science has uncovered that skin contains photoreceptors like those in the retina, so that when you step into the sun, both your skin and eyes senses the light. The skin also shares the same cells responsible for melanin production, and the skin also has light-sensitive chemicals, the same as found in the retina. Going back to the idea of the great shift from having singleness of mind to double-mindedness, this opened the door to duality. Yahuwah was training Eve to exercise and to strengthen her singleness of mind or eye, equipping her with the ability to surpass the tree of the knowledge of good and evil and press in to the tree of life. But we know that she failed this test by not pressing in towards the mark for the prize of the high calling of her maker in Mashiach Yahushua, who is the tree of life, who is the doorway to the Father. And we know there's only one way to Him, that is through Jesus the Messiah. So when we start to entertain the idea of entering other doors, you are now fondling with taking from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. This is the tree of options. There's nothing wrong with options. The problem lies in the ability to discern in choosing what is right over wrong. And we can have discernment only when we are mature in our faith and reverence to our Yahuwah, which can only be expressed in obedience. And how we mature into only choosing Yahuwah is by keeping His commandments. Yahuwah, our Maker, is not interested in becoming the number one in a list of 10 or 5 or 3. Our Maker wants us to choose Him from a list of 1. Yahuwah's desire was for Eve to choose from the tree of life first, proving her reverence to her Maker. And then she is now mature enough to be able to partake from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, establishing her divinity. Notice Genesis 3:22. This is spoken of by Yahuwah Elohim himself. He says, "Behold, the man has become like one of us, to know good and evil." That's inclusive of Yahuwah. This tells us there is nothing wrong with accessing or partaking from the tree of knowledge of good and evil. The problem with Eve was that she took from this tree so prematurely that she was not mature enough in her stand, in her right standing with her Maker, being able to rightly discern, rightly dividing the word of truth. And so she would not be susceptible to deception. And therefore, Yahuwah had to put an immediate stop to accessing the tree of life. That way, they don't become eternally immature. And you see this in the same text. And now, lest he put out his hand and take also of the tree of life and eat and live forever. So in this text alone, you can see that the tree of the knowledge of good and evil has something to do with becoming like God or establishing their divinity. The tree of life has something to do with eternal life or spirituality. Yahuwah is interested in establishing first her spirituality founded upon solid ground, founded upon the Mashiach, who is the tree of life himself. And then once she earned the right to partake from the tree of life, now she is ready to establish her divinity from taking from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Like newborn babies, we must crave the word of Yahuwah, his instructions, as if it were pure spiritual milk, so that we will grow into a full experience of salvation. So we can receive the end of our faith or the goal of our faith, the fulfillment of our purpose, and that is the salvation of our souls. In the next presentation, we will further our digging into understanding the importance in distinguishing between the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, the world of duality, and the tree of life, the singleness of mind, and the goal of our faith here on earth, that is to receive the right to take from the tree of life, which establishes our spirituality in our Mashiach, then we receive our divinity as sons and daughters of the Most High. And until then, be still and know.
The things which you learned and received and heard and saw in me, these do. And the God of peace will be with you.